Good morning, everybody. Good evening, everybody. Sorry, it's been a long day already. First order of business is Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you for everybody coming tonight and happy holidays. The first order of business tonight is public comment. Does anyone wish to speak of anything not on tonight's agenda? Seeing no one, we will move on. One thing we should mention from recognition is Mr. Brannigan pointed out to us that Paul Brady gave us a wonderful donation of $1,000. Patrick Brady, excuse me, gave us a wonderful donation of $1,000 from the Patrick Brady Band that's going to help pay it, the Finish Strong program. So we really appreciate that, and we thank him. This is a person who's done favors for us in the past, Mr. Brannigan, and helped us out in the past, but this was a sizable donation that he made, so we did want to make a comment and say thank you. And also, thank you very much. We did want to point out that also, it seems like every time of year, the Williams Trading Post goes out of its way, especially at the high school, to help out. This time of year, they provide the plants and the winter greens for the front of the building. I know they do a lot of work, especially around graduation time. And it's just one of those businesses in town that consistently, time and time again, help out the school system. So we do want to recognize them as many times as we can. So we do want to say thank you to them, too.
Mr.
Yes.
Chair? With regards to recognition, I'd like to just wish Terry to get well. I know she's probably watching or will be watching it soon. Terry's almost a seventh member here. We'll talk to us about items that she sees, and I appreciate everything she does, and I'm sure we all wish her well. And thank you for a great sweater that Mr. Lynch is wearing this evening. So thank you, Terry. Get well.
That's mistletoe color.
That's mistletoe, yes.
Next item is discussion items. Owen.
Thank you. Keep an eye on Mr. Brannigan's bulletin for upcoming home games. A few community service outreach programs to recognize. The Student Council collected over 600 items for the St. Vincent de Paul Food Pantry. The Key Club held their annual Eat to Heat fundraiser and helped 15 families keep the heat on this winter. The concert choir traveled to in the community to spread holiday cheer to those in need. And the Student Council's annual holiday party is next Wednesday from 5 to 8, and members of the Conway House will be joining us, so you're all invited to that. The Speech and Theater Workshop is holding their annual holiday coffee house next Tuesday, and the Music Department held their holiday concert this Tuesday. At the middle school, the musical Bye Bye Birdie was put on and attended to by capacity crowds at all shows. They've also kicked off their winter sports seasons, and their one-to-one initiative is going well so far. I had a chance to read Mr. Thompson's blog and was very impressed by the student-written Husky Happenings newspaper. And I had the opportunity to volunteer at the MKG Holiday Extravaganza, and it was a well-put-on event where all had a good time. So.
Any questions for Owen? Oh, and other than have a nice holiday this year, and I hope you enjoy your break a little bit. School committee members, Mr. Stevens. Report.
Yes, I too would like to wish our friend Terry a speedy recovery, and at this time I would like to wish all of our school families and community a peace and health and happiness in the new year. Thank you.
I wish Terry good health, and also to wish the community a happy holiday.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. There are so many things going on in this in our community, top to bottom, from Breakfast with Santa that's occurred to the concert, the concerts, I say plural, from the choir to the band this past Tuesday evening at the high school. So there are so many things and still to come this season and moving forward. And I like when I open up the paper and you see things and what's going on, and whether it was the Eat to Heat serving, I think it was 16 families are being served by the funds that were raised, to the money that was raised this past Tuesday for one of our families in our community that had had a fire at their home. So a good amount of money was raised during that event, a substantial amount, which it's a community that we belong to, and it's great to see our students, what the students do, and they're a part of our community, and it kind of makes me proud to just be sitting here, but it makes me proud to see what these students are doing, these young adults, because I don't call them kids because they are definitely adults with what they're doing. So when I think about it, I just think we all should remember these young adults and what they're doing. And thank you, and thank you, Owen, and what you do as well. Thanks.
Thank you. I do want to also wish Terry a speedy recovery, and I'm sure we'll all be hearing from her soon. I do want to point out something to the community, and I think it's important. For those who participate in winter sports, those kids don't get a vacation. Those kids continue to practice in some respects, they lose their February vacation and they lose their winter vacation. So first of all, we appreciate the work that those kids do and the things that they do to help. And I also know, for example, the speech and theater group are putting on, working on the play right now that will go to competition. But I do want to point out to the community that both right before school breaks, the basketball team's first home game is the Friday before Christmas, and there is a home game that week, as I'm sure there are games for the girls' teams and wrestling and things like that. And if you're around and have a few minutes, for a lot of people don't go anyplace there. They sort of go for the weekend for Christmas and stuff like that. It'd be great to pack the houses for those events and to really show those kids that we appreciate not only what they do, but the fact that by their dedication, they're losing some of their vacation time and they're working on those days to represent the high school and our community. So I do want to bring that out. Next item on our is the superintendent report, and I think we're going to jump around a little to start with. Mr. Lynch?
I think, we're going to start with the Futures Program. So if I could invite Mr. Joshua Porter down to the microphone, and I believe that Donnie Jameson is going to join him. Mr. Joshua Porter is the administrator in charge of our Futures Program at the high school. It has been a three-year fulfillment program. And Mr. Porter is here tonight to talk about possible expansion of that program to include a fourth year. Currently, if a student enters that program, fulfills the program in 3 years, the student, young person, would have to wait another year to get their diploma. So I think we're trying to expand that program for a fourth year because we have students who would be eligible walking into the high school, and this would be a real advantage to have this a four-year program. So without further ado, Mr. Porter, thank you, Josh, and thank you, Donnie, for coming.
Thanks for having me. I do want to just kind of expand and talk about the program, where it's been, where it's at, and where I'd like to see it go, and hopefully, have your blessing to make some structural changes to it. A quick overview, as Mr. Lynch said, the Futures Program is our alternative high school, our school within a school at the high school. It's a three-year program. Our current structure is divided into 3 years. We call it year one, year two, and year three. Our year one and two students take classes, 720 to 150, 8 45-minute classes for the year, which is different from our mainstream students, which take, the same time on learning over the course of a semester class. When they get to that year three, the program was designed as I inherited it, and Ms. Jameson is here as the former director to put any historical touches on it. They come 3 days a week from 720 to 1015, take four classes each semester for a total of eight, which models or mirrors the night school, and they're also required to do an internship or part-time work. In addition to that, there's been a dialogue over the last few years about making it a four-year program because we've identified kids at the middle school level who may benefit from an alternative experience, but because of their age, to graduate someone at 16 in a 3-to-3-year program just didn't make sense to us. So we've talked over the last 3 years of how to do it, and this year we've kind of sat down with our staff, and I'm going to present to you what I think is the best way to go. So as you see here on this slide, I think I gave out some copies. This is basically just our current schedule. with our teacher one, teacher two, teacher three. And while the program's not a special education program, it also has the capability of including students who are in special education. So we have our special educator come down for that one block a day and teach those two classes. So we're running it, like I said, a schedule and a schedule. We have the two years with the year-long classes, then year three, it's a drastic shift to semester classes. It's important to talk about the diploma here. There's a big difference between the high school diploma and the futures diploma. The futures diploma allows you, by the time that your career is done in those 3 years, to go to any two-year school, trade school, or the military. Basically, what it does, it meets the state standards, and then from the two-year school, you can transfer into a four-year college. And then our futures diploma versus our community evening school diploma, which is kind of the crux of the shift, they're earning the same diploma as you would if you went to community evening school. And you know, over the course of time, whether it's mainstream or futures, we see to tend to lose kids to night school. But the key here is when you go to the community evening school, you're required to take 20 hours of a class, and then you receive, like I said, that diploma that allows you to go to a two-year school. And as you see in the next slide here, as I kind of present the four-year schedule, I think the key thing here to point out too when I talk about that time on learning is if we create a four-year schedule here, as you can see, as your first and second year as a freshman and a sophomore, you're gonna have 129 hours per class, which is up from that 20 hours you would receive in night school. In addition, in that junior year, 109 hours, in the senior year, 75 hours. That number in parentheses with the rework of this schedule is up 6 hours and 10 hours a year from our current structure. So as you can see here, students would come in, our freshman and sophomore, 7:20 to 12:45, which I'll get to that 12:45 in a little bit. I know it's an earlier dismissal in the high school. And to talk about that transition block, we can take that first year, teach life skills, study skills to those kids coming up to teach some core skills that they can use as they transition to the high school. In that sophomore year in that same block, which we run an MCAS prep class now, those sophomores can do that. And then we also allow, which we don't really have time for now based on the three-year schedule, if that sophomore does not pass the MCAS, then as a junior, they can also take that MCAS prep class with their sophomores as well. Let me just skip ahead here. So why the shift, and just some reasons why this has been a conversation over the last few years. Age of the student as a barrier. Like I said, if we have that true ninth grader walking in the front door at a young 14, if they were to enter the program right away, they'd graduate at 16, which obviously, if they're looking for an alternative experience, they may not have the skill set to walk out at 16 and be, equipped with the skills that they're gonna need. And right now, there's a kind of a gap in programming. We didn't have a spot for them. So what we do now is, with Project Success this year that Mr. Brannigan created, they'll end up in there and kind of see how it goes. And I don't want to lose that time. Not necessarily we're losing it, but we have kids now that we've identified that could benefit from the program that are in Project Success that we got to kind of see how it goes. And then we can transition them down at that, the end of the first semester. The afternoon for this population, the student is a huge, it's a major breakdown just because for these kids to come to school, to stay attentive all day, it's often difficult. And 14-15, we actually changed our schedule to allow for all of our core classes to be before lunch. Because like I said, to keep these kids who are school phobic or have other issues that are going on, it posed a challenge. As I talk about kind of that 12:45 dismissal, we've talked about the ability to meet with outside providers. A lot of these students that are, meet the criteria that are in this program have teams of people working with them and outside agencies, which would allow them time to meet and provide those services so they can function. Again, the increased time on learning from the current structure, as you saw, 6 and 10 hours, and a huge jump from our night school with the required 20 hours. I said, we have some of our most reluctant learners, and we're kind of running them through the ringer to earn kind of the same diploma that for them they can see that, if I go and I pay the money or I want to go to night school, I can do it at, almost a lesser time commitment, so I'm trying to find a happy medium. Currently, as the program stands, We can roughly carry about 20 students. If we went to this new structure, we'd be able to accommodate up to 32, which is about an 8-to-1 ratio. So some of those kids that could really benefit, we could definitely take them in. Ability to transition from mainstream to the program and the program to back to mainstream. Right now, with the running of two schedules, it's often tough to piecemeal together transcripts or whatnot because there are a lot of gaps. This would allow, if a student comes into the program, does well, they're going to earn the same number of credits as they would if they were not mainstream, and then they can transition out, or it'll be an easier transition in. So it allows for some flexibility for those who do well. More chances to sit for MCAS. Like I said, some of our students, you know, aren't as successful the first time, but then we can prep them and allow them the opportunity to have those 2 other years to sit for the test. We've had students in the past who had to come back the following year, and it's tough to, you know, prep them in the way that we would find appropriate if they were waiting until the end of, you know, their senior year or that third year. A lot of these students, you know, have other mental health issues, school phobia, so to get them there, like I said, the morning is something we've identified as the key time of day for these students. This would allow us the ability to re-engage students who have already dropped out or are contemplating it. A lot of these students, if you were to ask them, would have already dropped out at this point without kind of the creativity of the staff down there, because they're the ones that, you know, that make it work. Right now, currently in the program, that are enrolled, we've re-engaged 2 students who dropped out last year, and then the year before we re-engaged a student who graduated last year. Staffing and space, at this point, I'm not looking for any more staffing or space. I've had the blessing of Carolyn Lyons to give me that special educator for another block, which would allow that schedule to work. And in terms of the space, for those of you who've seen the program, there's a space out back that all I'd really be looking for is a partition and maybe a whiteboard. The desks are already there to create that 4th teacher space. And again, I think the schedule works for these students in particular because some of our students are caregivers of their own, you know, may have children of their own and also potentially are sole providers of their families or for their families. I have students right now who work close to 40 to 50 hours a week, and I have in the past. So in order to grandfather everybody into the program, because those are as advertised, if advertised as a 3-year program, we would need to have like an interim schedule, which we'd have to run next year. So it would be our 9th and 10th graders would be on this 4-year schedule, totally straight as it was presented in 2 slides ago. Our 11th and 12th graders, which are currently enrolled in the program now, would have to go to a semester schedule next year. So they'd have to take the classes in the fall and then the spring, which is different than the way the structure is currently. But at that point though too, the juniors would have like 59 hours time on learning, and the seniors would have close to the 42. And that's, again, that's up from the current structure, and it's up from that 20, that initial 20 that kind of, you know, sparked this conversation. So in order to be, you know, kind of fit in line with the contract, the way the schedule is developed to really hit that morning hard with these core classes, it would allow that last block for all the teachers with these at-risk students to have as a common planning time, a prep time to sit and meet, have parent meetings, be able to do some, you know, cross-curricular activities, collaborate, et cetera, which, you know, for this population in particular, it's tough to get that time to carve out of the day and make sure that we're meeting these kids' needs where they're at. The exploration, career exploration and work study, the way the schedule's set up, which I can show you in detail later if you're interested, it would allow on Friday mornings for our teachers to be able to do work site visits. The time is allowed because, you know, those other students are still only there 3 days a week. Allow them to get in the community and be like a true advisor, advisee, and advisory program. Again, the transportation, I know these slides are kind of sparse, but I mean, this is kind of the biggest crux, and I think maybe the 12:45 dismissal. Right now, our year threes leave at 10:13. Dismissal's never been an issue for us. They're self-sufficient. The parents know coming in that that's the end of the day. Some schools in the surrounding areas, they run different schedules on 11 to 6 in one area. Some run, you know, a 3 to 7 schedule. So that, I think, is kind of right now the biggest area of kind of discussion or concern that we'd have to just make sure that everyone was on the same page with. And questions, conversation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for this presentation. A couple questions. If we make this change and go to a 4-year program, the students that are in this program, what will their diploma be?
Now, it would be the it's a Middleborough High School Futures Diploma, which it allows them. It meets the state minimum requirements to go to a 2-year school, a trade school, or the military.
Okay. How many, if we make this change, how many of the students are going to be affected? I call them the 11th grade students, 11th, 12th grade. How many do we have in the program right now that will get affected by it?
Right now we have 19, and it would be 13 students.
Okay. If they were really affected by it, would they maybe consider that transition, unfortunately, to that night program versus the additional education, which I would prefer to see?
So the conversation we could have, as presented in this presentation, is to tell a student right now who's, say, a freshman, that they plan to have 2 more years, to say now you have 3. That's a tough pill to swallow because they're already behind a year because they're age appropriate. It's a conversation we can definitely have with their parents if they wanted to, stay that extra year, because we're going to have that fourth year built in already.
Right.
But we're really just talking about those year ones going to that third year, because our second years are basically going to go to that quote unquote fourth year, which would be the third year, and that schedule is not going to change as presented, as the two semesters.
And you said a petition and whiteboards is really all you need, because with Carolyn allowing that shift in with the ELA and MCAS.
Correct.
So we're not even talking about additional staffing right at this time, unless
correct.
The program were.
For sure. Right now, that special educator would come down and teach the 4 English classes. And literally, I kind of size the space. I just need a partition with a door, and the desks are there, and a whiteboard. Yeah.
Thank you for those answers.
Mr. Lambert.
Just a quick question. Yeah. I'm not 100% clear on how the diploma works with the state requirements. If you could just explain that a little bit.
So if you look at the community evening school, the model originally was to provide them that opportunity during the day. So basically you have to take your 4 English, your 3 or 4 math, depending on your MCAS scores, your 3 history, your 3 science, and then your electives in your gym.
Okay.
So at that point, in terms of going to that 2-year school, with your foreign language and your art and your technology, that's what the 4-year colleges look for in terms of entrance when you apply.
So the only difference in terms of diplomas, they couldn't just go directly to a 4-year school?
Correct. And I will say this population of student, we had this conversation at the beginning before they're entered or admitted into the program. That's a conversation that's happened, and they're not, again, to date, are not on that 4-year track maybe at that point in time. But, we've had many students go on to that 2-year. The 2-year track to start.
Thank you.
So.
You mentioned that there's the possibility that someone could start out freshman year in this program, yet they could, with a new schedule, they could possibly transition right into the regular high school.
Correct.
Which is a kind of added bonus on this whole piece.
It is an added bonus, because they would have like the same amount of core credits about the end of the year. So say they did really well and excelled. We've never really had the opportunity to do that based on the schedule, within the schedule. So it can work both ways. We could take someone who's in mainstream, who we thought was gonna be a rock star, and if they're floundering or other things, life events happen, we'll be able to take them in with open arms and transition them down without missing a beat, and vice versa the same way.
Thank you.
Mr. Porter, I just have a couple of questions. One, as a negative, do you see any potential to lose kids in the idea that it's a 4-year program as opposed to 3 as you move forward?
I don't necessarily see it as a negative. I think it's a positive for those younger kids coming right in, because the relationships we build, and like I joke with the kids and the families, like once you're in the program, I'm in your life like a tick. Like, you're in calls daily just to kind of check in. The only necessarily negative I see is if someone starts, as an older incoming 9th grader, who may have been stayed back once or twice. Now they're, 16 years old as a freshman. They still have 4 years to go, but I think I could pitch it as, well, if you transition to the mainstream, you'd also have 4 years, and this way, with a little bit shorter day, a shorter condensed schedule, you know, as you, you know, 18, 19 at the end, you'll be able the ability to go work and start to do some career exploration type things.
And the other question I have, if circumstances change for some of those kids, mm-hmm. would there be the potential that they could move into the community school if they needed to?
Oh, for sure. Anybody's eligible to go to the community right. school. I just think, you know, at some points for these kids, it, you know, it could be a financial piece. It could be, you know, a whole myriad of issues that, you know, we could provide right in-house, you know, with the resources that we have already available to us.
And the only other thing that I want to bring up, it's just because we're going to have this discussion mm-hmm. later. Your program set up as wonderfully as you currently can.
Yes.
Because we're going to discuss later the MSBA and mm-hmm. Mr. Brannigan's education plan. This is not really, there are more things you'd like to do with this program that we can't do based on the space. Am I correct in that?
Correct. I mean, the partition and the whiteboard, I mean, another classroom would be great. We had the luxury last year and the support of the school committee to kind of build it out because of 3 years ago, all it was a bunch of partitions and you could hear everything that was going on. But I know I've talked to Mr. Brannigan pretty extensively about the plans going forward and the space and, you know, in terms of where it's at now, you know, things are kind of where they need to be in the plan.
And moving forward, for a lot of these kids, the pieces that we're missing, what we'd really like to add on to are really the life skills components mm-hmm. for these kids. For example, a kitchen and things like that, which they would use every day in their life, but we can't add those pieces currently.
For sure. For sure, the life skills piece, you know, some of those vocational pieces. You know, a lot of our kids are pretty handy, and, you know, they have skills that we maybe around this table don't, that they really can utilize, that we don't have a way to kind of, you know, highlight them for them in the current structure.
And the biggest piece for me, too, is we highlight those pieces that they more or less have a tendency to stay.
Correct.
If you're highlighting things they want to do and learn.
Right. I think we do a lot of great things at the high school for a lot of different you know, populations of kids, and I just, you know, I sit here before you tonight making sure that we're reaching these kids too and maybe highlighting the things that they're good at or, you know, what the hand that they were dealt, you know, so.
Mr. Lynch.
Mr. Chair, we are not necessarily looking for a vote this evening. We are looking just generally for a feeling amongst the committee on whether or not this is something you'd entertain. So as Mr. Porter designs his program of studies for this year, he can frame it around this as opposed to his current setup. So not necessarily, Mr. Porter.
Sorry, it's just a kind of a quick add-on to that is, excuse me, to move forward with this four-year plan, if we, whatever it is, a vote or whatnot down the road, if we could, by the end of like the first semester, because the planning would begin second semester, the planning would begin with maybe transitioning some kids already down to the program this year in hopes that, you know, the next year there'll be a four-year program. We have some students in there who are in there for some extended, you know, observation or evaluations that, you know, the four-year plan versus the three-year plan is going to impact, you know, where it best fits for them. So just wanted to add that into.
I thought one of them was going to be cleared up with a question that Mr. Giovannone asked, but I still have questions. Mm-hmm. Depending upon your explanation, I may or may not have concerns. You currently have grades 9, 10, and 11 kids only in this program. Is that right or not right?
No, it varies. We can't, based on the way the structure is, I can't say it's a, you know, 9, 10, 11. It's like a year one, year two, year three. So our year threes are our seniors, but they've all been in school for 4 years. So they've had a rough freshman year. You know, they've come down and repeated that first year, and then we've built 1, 2, and 3.
Okay, so at most, these kids are going to be with you for 3 years, currently?
Currently with me in the program for 3, high school 4. So they'll be in high school for 4 years. With me in the program, if they came in at the beginning, 3 years.
Okay. Now, let's assume you get the four-year program. Mm-hmm. This is where I'm still a little bit confused. All of the kids currently in this program mm-hmm. who will not graduate this June from you, are you saying they're going to be made to go to a fourth year? Did I hear that correctly?
No, I'm not. So that interim schedule, is a schedule to get them to graduate in the one or two years that they're currently projected to graduate in, which was advertised, you say, if they came in last year for a three-year program.
So the only one who, if this is approved, the only group of kids that would go for 4 years with you would be those who are currently in grade eight?
Grade eight, grade nine, or anybody who transitions in grade 10.
So if I transition in grade 10, I'm with you for four more years. So I'm in high school for 14 years,
if,
not 12.
If you have the credits, say this year, you say you have student A who graduates or finishes their ninth grade year, has the credits to be a sophomore, but they have attendance issues, things are going on at home, and this experience might be a better fit for them, they would transition in with us at grade 10, 11, and 12. So they would be in for 3 years, 4 years of high school. That eighth grader who transitions right up would be 4 years. We might have a student who's been in mainstream for 3 years, has all their credits, you know, some catastrophic event happens, and then we could transition them in under this schedule as a 12th grader, so it'd still be a total of 4 years.
Okay. With this program, what has bothered me, and you stated it tonight, is a 16-year-old student getting out of high school being done as a result of this program. I am strongly in favor of 4 years, and I thank the two of you for bringing this. What I do not want to see is anybody currently in that program expecting to get out after the 3 years, however you count them, now having to spend another year with you. I wouldn't want anybody to be penalized.
Nope, and that's that whole interim year that I built in. And again, my presentation to you all is with the time on learning piece, like next year would be kind of like that stopgap year where they're getting more than they would at the community evening school, but they're not going to be getting that full 129 or, you know, 109 hours just for that 1 year, so no one's penalized and have to do another year, unless a parent or there's a conversation where they see fit or if they're, you know, credits are an issue or whatnot.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And I want to thank you for both of you, because Mrs. Jameson, you ran the program before, and it's a wonderful program, and thank you for all that you do with a group of students. Thanks. Thank you.
Yeah. On the proposed four-year schedule,
yeah.
Are you saying that if they, in your program, freshman and sophomore, under the new, the proposed schedule, if they're doing well and they want to transition, they could transition to the mainstream?
They could.
And potentially graduate with a high school degree, the Middleborough
Correct.
High School?
Correct. Okay. With the understanding they'll have to take the foreign language and the arts and the technology and that type of thing.
But right now, that under the current plan, that's more difficult because the things don't line up.
That's much more difficult to transition in, especially when you do that semester schedule that last year, and who knows what their record or their schedule looks like the first couple of years of high school.
Thank you.
Yes. Kids in the past that you would recommend moving to the high school that, you know, if pieces were in place that would help that kid, that you could see a couple of kids that could follow that and move into the high school that way but couldn't in the past?
For sure. Okay. Yeah. Short answer, yes. I'll keep it short.
So, I mean, you know, those kids are missing out. We just don't have the opportunity available to them again that we could have under this system.
Correct.
Okay. Brian.
Mr. Chair, our next school committee meeting is January 5th. Would we want to put a discussion and possible vote on that agenda? Because I know we wouldn't want to vote tonight, although I would vote for it tonight. Hint, hint. And I don't know what the rest of the temperature is, but I think this is something that is I don't want to say no-brainer, but it's a no-brainer.
I think at the next meeting, Mr. Lynch, if I'm correct, Mr. Brannigan's going to put forward his program of studies.
Mm-hmm.
Now, my assumption, and I shouldn't make the assumption I'm going to ask, Mr. Brannigan, is it your intention to move forward with this four-year plan in your program of studies? Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much. Then, when will we do the futures program of studies, Mr. Lynch?
We can do it on January 5th if you'd like. Will it be ready? Do you think, Josh?
Yeah. I mean, we can be ready to go.
Then can I go around the table and ask the committee if Mr. Porter should go ahead and present the plan in January for 4 years of study, Mr. Stevens?
Say.
To present a four-year plan to continue forward with this program. understanding what he said, which was for the current children in the program, they would still be the, they wouldn't be penalized, they would still have the 3 years, but going forward, new students would be in a four-year program.
So you asking if I'm in favor of it?
Yes.
Going forward, yeah, I'm in favor.
Mr. Gillis?
I'm in favor of it.
Mr. Lambert?
I am as well.
I am too.
And as am I. And so my suggestion would you would come back to us, and yeah. I believe we could take that vote if you're ready in that meeting, or we could do the 20th, whatever works best for you.
I'll be ready on the 5th.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll be ready on the 5th. We'll have it on the agenda.
Awesome.
And we'll get necessary documentation with us the Friday before so we can send it to school committee.
You got it.
Okay.
Thank you, guys. Thank you all.
Mr. Porter, we appreciate it.
And thank you, Donnie.
Friday before is New Year's Eve.
Ah.
I'll be in by 7 o'clock.
Fine with me. I just didn't want these two to, have to. Do you want to get it ready New Year's Eve? I'm not going to read it New Year's Eve. I'll guarantee you that.
We'll get it set. We'll be at the Tiki Buddha waiting for our Chinese food, and we'll email it out to school committee.
And you will be waiting.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
Moving on, I think if with the permission of the chair, I think if we could change a little order here. And as they're walking up, I can do item number 3. But I would invite Mr. Brannigan to come on up at this time. I would also invite Rob DeRozier, who's chairman of the Middleborough High School Building Committee, to come just down just to give us a quick update. We had a big meeting yesterday, and he's not going to stay for the entire presentation because he's seen it yesterday. But he's here with his daughter, Maggie. And he just wants to provide the committee with the most recent update from the MHS building project. Mr. DeRozier, thank you for coming tonight. Thank you for dedication for this project, and take it away.
Thank you. The committee's on track. We're doing really well with our architect and our project manager. It turns out they're as good a team as we originally told you they were. The next big hurdle for us is to get into the MSBA, a preliminary design program, which will include 5 options for school design. It'll include the educational plan that Mr. Brannigan's going to give you an overview of, and space use, all kinds of documents that have been developed over the last 3 or 4 months with the architect as a submission to the MSBA to get their approval to move on to the next phase, which will be schematic design and costing out of the options. Everything's on track. We're ready to go. The only hurdle we have left is to get you guys to review and approve the educational plan so we can move forward and submit it.
Any questions for Mr. DeRozier? Mr. Chair.
I think the thing we want to say too, as I said at the meeting, and I'll say 100 times so everybody in town can hear, it's our belief we moved from 10 to 5. By beginning of spring, we'll move to one option. And that one option will be vetted over the summertime. There will be a special town meeting in October asking for people to put it on the ballot. If that's allowed, then we will move to the opportunity to have a town meeting vote for, again, the options that went forward are repair and revision and new. So one of those 5 options that we presented the other day will be what happens with the high school. And we want people to know that.
That's true. And if I might add, where we are now is based upon a lot of public input. We've Absolutely. Had forums where we gathered information on where we want to go as a school. We had visioning sessions with stakeholders. We had a forum at the high school to gather input from the community as we went forward and looked at those 10 options. We had a forum recently at Oak Point where we gathered public input, and that factored strongly into arriving at the 5 options we are going forward now. And there'll be another big meeting. Public input is invited in January, February, which will help us further develop those options and then eventually winnow them down to just one in the spring.
I would like to also add, I mean, we have a committee of about 15 or 16,
17.
Whittling down to the 5 was a unanimous vote of those 17 people. And so I think that's important to know that, you know, this is what has really been worked out over a long period of time, and people have done a tremendous amount of work, and you especially included for all you do, and I want to thank you for that.
Thanks.
Mr. Chair, I think it's important that the community know that the option to build on this site, the Nichols Middle School site, was eliminated at yesterday's building project meeting. That was a big step, but that was well vetted out and determined that the high school and its accompanying athletic fields, along with the fields that are required by this school, would not fit appropriately in that space, and we'd still be transporting students to the old high school grounds for sports and things such as that. So it's important to note that that Nichols Middle School site, this site has been eliminated as a possibility for a new or a new high school anyways. And obviously an addition renovation would be the current site. Thank you.
One of the other pieces that we discussed at that meeting last night, when we took the vote, is that this information is all online. We keep putting information online, and the final selected pieces will be put online as a separate item during this week. I know our OPM is working on that to get the slides, so people will be able to see what it was pared down to. All the options were available, I believe, right up until, they still are on there. At one of our previous meetings and the meeting we had here as well, it's on the website called MHS Building Committee. I'm sorry, MHSBuildingProject.com, MHSBuildingProject.com. And when you click on meeting minutes right on the tab and go right to the bottom, there are the there's a PDF of options there so people can see them. I also believe that the video last night will be aired. It'll be continued to be aired on Community Access, so you can see that meeting that we had last night. It was about an hour and a half long. It was a comprehensive meeting, and I advise people to take a peek at it, and if there's any questions, to get a hold of any of us.
Paul, you're going to talk to us today, even with your bad voice, about the education plan, which I know you worked quite a bit on.
Thank you, Mr. DeRozier.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I'm going to do the very best I can. Just a horrible cold. It is really quite an honor to share with you tonight the preliminary education plan for Middleborough High School. This really is just when you ask what an education plan is, it really is the comprehensive document about what a 21st century Middleborough High School would look like. It also reflects either a new building or a renovation building. So when you have an opportunity as a community to read this document, it doesn't reflect one or the other, it's both. And so whatever the decision may be. It is also with the collective voice of a staff and a faculty and a school community, which I think you will find transcending through the document as well. The education plan must align with what is called the proposed space summary, which it has to align with the square footage that the MSBA is allowing us to have, to how we're utilizing that square footage. So the document that our architects are working on has to align pretty perfectly with this education plan. So when you see the education plan, it will tell the story of a high school, and then the numbers must match it as well in regards of really what the rooms would be and so on. And you'll also notice that it's due to the MSBA on December 23rd of this year. Just really quick, just a list of the people who were instrumental in adding their expertise into this plan, from technology to science, the Center for Innovative Studies, Phys Ed, special education, safety and security, and also the Director of Alternative Pathways. And I do need to add Mrs. Danielle Duggan, who is the Director of Fine Arts, or excuse me, Department Chair for Fine Arts as well. Just to tell you as a community where this came from, our vision planning, which I know I spoke to all of you about earlier this year, we had 3 days at the Boston Tavern where 45 members of the school community members, came together to really talk about the vision of a new high school. Dr. Frank Locker was our consultant for those 3 days, and coming out of that, we had a really great blueprint, really very in a rough stage of really what a Middleborough High School could be. We then had 2 full days of what is called architectural programming, where the architects came in and spent the entire 2 days with every member of our faculty and staff. So everybody in the building had an opportunity to talk about what kind of facility are we currently in, the kind of resources they're using now, and the resources that they feel we should have to make teaching and learning much better. And then from there, from the end of September to now, the writing begins. And really what I'm going to share with you is just really the table of contents with some really key highlights of the document. It is a pretty extensive document. It's about 60 pages long, and it's important for you as a committee as well as the community to know. A lot of the document speaks to really how the high school is functioning now, because that is very much an instrumental piece of this process for the MSBA, because they need to be able to glean inside of our walls to see exactly what it's like. But then you'll notice in the document, we'll talk about what our building is currently like, but then you'll see sentences such as the vision is, where we talk about where we'd like to be. If you look at the education plan and the highlights in our introduction, it just talks about our story, our history, setting the stage, our vision planning sessions, as well as our architectural programming. When you get to grade and configuration, it talks about really what our highlights are. And you notice all the things that are there in regards to our current schedule, our freshman academy, how we provide special education services, our program of studies. It is important to note that when you see the current schedule, the design of the new high school would not impact the schedule. And that's really important, because you know that we as a school community have been really taking a good hard look at our schedule. And that's really an instrumental thing for you as a committee to know, that regardless of what the design may be, it doesn't impact what our current schedule could be or an evolution of a schedule over the next few years. If you notice the vision, you'll see in a brand new design of a high school that we would like to keep the departmental structure of the building, meaning an English department, a math department, a science department, and so on. However, you'll note that we talk about collaboration. It was imperative for the vision planning sessions and to the faculty that they want to keep their identity, but they also want to make sure that they could create interdisciplinary opportunities as well. You'll notice special education programming, which is paramount to our backbone of our school, as well as the enhancement of our current program of studies. The class size policies. We talk about our overall class sizes. We talk about our specialty courses, our advanced placement program, and then we really bring into the vision. We want to maintain that our building has flexible space for the increase of enrollment in the future, not only of population, but also of an evolution of a program as well. In a focus on the arts, phys ed, and general classroom space, we talked a lot about the structure of the building now and its limitations, and we want to make sure the fact that the new building has flexible space so that we're growing over the years of that building as well. The school schedule. We highlight our block schedule. We're highlighting our schedule within a schedule, which is the project success, as well as our advisory. The vision is to evolve our schedule, which we know that is something we're still working at, and quite possibly going into a new school or a renovated building, you may find that there would be a very different looking schedule potentially. The new or renovated would have no impact on the schedule, which I shared, which is really important for the school community to know. It's also flexible and to maintaining a very rigorous and vibrant advisory program. The teaching and methodology structure. In the highlights, we talk about our overhaul of curriculum instruction and assessment, professional development, the implementation of our accountability plan, as well as the foundation of our literacy plan. If you notice in the vision, we had to be able to talk about what would teaching look like and how would teachers run through the school. We really want to keep the departmental configuration. However, we really want to look at centers, a humanities center, a STEM center, and so on, which you'll see in just a moment. Common spaces and breakout spaces. We want to have the ability to do a large group presentation, but we also want to make sure the place was flexible to be able to break into smaller groups as well to create that space. We want to make sure the building fosters interdisciplinary learning, as well as all the classrooms are flexible in approach. Teaching and planning. We talked about in the highlights, really what is the function of the day-to-day operation of a teacher. We talk about the department offices and the lack of some department offices currently in the building. You'll notice that in this vision, we really want to make sure that our teaching centers for every department really has a collaborative feel to it that is going to allow for work to be done individually, but also in teams. You'll notice a department office, a collaborative workspace slash conference area. There'd be a kitchenette in all of the department areas. Technology saturated through not only the building, but also within these department offices. There would be a television studio, not in every department, but there would be some capability within all the with all the department offices to make sure there could be some film, some video that could be done or created as well, because that is something we envision in every part of the school as well, especially when you're looking at project-based learning. And then you would notice the fact that our humanities departments would be together and our STEM departments would be together as well. And what would we envision? In our vision planning, it became clear that we were thinking about having a building that very mirrored a college-looking experience. You would notice a humanities center where our English and Language Arts department would be housed, history, foreign language, and special ed. You would notice the STEAM, and I kept referring earlier to STEM, but as this process has evolved, we really started to look at the infusion of the visual arts program into our science, technology, engineering, and math programs. And you will notice the areas of the building that will be housed in STEM. And we came up with the title, the Center for Innovative Studies, which we really feel will really speak to our 21st century approach to teaching and learning. We envision a health and wellness center where physical education, athletics, we envision a counseling center that would house our school psychologists and potential adjustment counselors to really have almost an access center of some kind for our student body. It would also house special education programming, as well as our futures program, which I'll share about that in just a moment, and also our performing arts center, which would have music, theater, visual arts as well, because we wanted to make sure that in the performing arts that there would be some components of the visual arts still embedded in the music and theater program, as well as the auditorium and TV studio. Our lunch programs. You'll notice in the vision, we hope to go back down to three lunches, and that would be doable with a much larger space. You also notice, what would it look like? We call it our student commons and our large dining commons. The envision that we vision for this space is that before and after school, it would be the hub of our student body. It would be the meeting place, the collaborative space. It would be where student activities would be run through after school. It would allow for a large area to be opened up to create the cafeteria model that maybe many of us are envisioning. But it would also allow, when the cafeteria is not being used for lunches, to also be able to be a collaborative space for a presentation and large group works, things of that nature. We also envision along the sides very small breakout areas that could open up into the larger space, but could close as well into much smaller areas for small group instruction potentially during the day, but also for clubs, activities, and outside groups to potentially use that space as well. We call it the hub of student life programming, and it would be saturated with technology. We also envision the look of it to be very much like a student union you would see at any college or university. Technology. This is much more extensive than what I have here for you, but it gives you just an overview. We talk about our current structure. We talk about the significant technology improvements that have happened at the high school. We vision the continuation of the one-to-one initiative and environment. Department offices would be saturated with technology. We see two high-end computer labs that would really foster the work we're doing right now in STEM at the high school to ensure the fact that our computers would be able to do the program we were looking to do. We'd have one computer lab for fine arts. That would be a music production lab, as well as a digital imaging lab, as well as a CAD lab. A language lab, TV studio, and then, of course, technology that would be saturated in all areas of the school. We envision that certain places you would go, there may be a flat screen TV, and that during times it could be running announcements, but at the same exact time, it could also serve as a collaborative space for kids to be able to do meetings and to also be able to do small breakout. Our media center learning commons. We envision this to be the heartbeat of the school. It would be accessible from all content areas. It would be flexible in its space, again, to mirror almost that student union or student center in the dining commons. It would foster large group collaboration, but also small group breakouts as well. Flexible furniture, technology rich, having desktop computers for students, as well as charging stations. We needed to make sure the fact that the computers in the learning commons were of a high end to ensure the fact that students just didn't need to be working in the computer lab. If they were working on a CAD project, they would be able to work on those same items in our learning commons. We would also envision having a writing lab and a math lab, very small in scope, but it would allow for teachers and students to come together for real specialized instruction of tutoring and so on. We also look at an instructional technology help desk. Many schools have these, whether it be run by staff or by students, as well as a book collection area. But we really see over the years to come, we need to ensure the fact that we begin to move towards a digital content. And you'll also notice there'll be a large enough workshop space for professional development as well as community events. Guidance and counseling. We envision a much larger guidance space with private offices and a collaborative workspace. A college and career readiness center to really foster the work that is being done right now in partnership with Massasoit Community College. We envision a classroom presentation space, which would also serve as a transition room that would allow for our ACE program to continue, but also to do programming and workshops through guidance, as well as our counseling center. Our science. In a lot of conversations about what we would do with 7 science labs, this is what we envision. We would have a full lab that would be dedicated to engineering and robotics, one lab that would be dedicated strictly to physics, 2 for biology, 2 for chemistry, and 1 would be a general lab. We felt strongly about having a lab that was quite flexible, that we could run programs like environmental science, our oceanography program. We're hoping to launch a marine biology initiative next year to really begin to build some of these other lab sciences. We envision in the ed plan, when you read it, that it would allow for that space to be connected to the community. Our environmental science kids are always going down to the Nemasket River to do water samples. How does that transfer into a lab at the high school? We potentially envision a large aquarium or fish tank to be able to really look at species that they could be studying in oceanography. And really, the beginning of a fabrication and makerspace, which I will share with you shortly. The Performing Arts Center. For the vision of this is really a combined space for music and theater. It would be a combined space for band and choral. It would have flexible space for classrooms, a black box theater, a true black box theater, as well as a state-of-the-art auditorium and performance space. For the visual arts, we envision 2 very large classrooms that are flexible, that they can break into 2 separate rooms, but also have a very large area to work from. An installation of a kiln to be able to continue and foster new programming, as well as the beginnings of true engagement of a 3-dimensional art design and art programming. We're beginning that with our graphic arts and our digital imaging, but we really do need to be moving art in a 21st century way. We're really looking at student activities. We want to create a student council, student life office that would become the pride room for the school. It would be accessible for all activities of papers and markers, supplies, very similar to what our students are used to today. There would also be surrounding that area would be those breakout areas that I spoke of earlier in the dining commons. A business college career readiness center. This is really something that we wanted to begin looking at. Working with Massasoit, currently, and with the work we're doing with our college to career program of our internships, we're hoping to really foster this program to really have our students identify where do they see themselves going. And if college doesn't happen to be the place where they're thinking of going, then how do we help them find those careers that they could be engaging in? It would be a meeting space that would have significant resources, technology, ability to do meetings and programming and workshops, and have direct connection in some way, shape, or form to college and universities. We envision a space for our ELL population and for our ELL staff member to be able to use that space as a student resource area and also a resource area for parents and guardians within our community. We envision this would be housed inside the Humanities Center. Phys Ed. I have two slides here for you. One is going to show the changes or the vision of the interior. A much larger gym space that would go from a 9,000 square foot gym to a 12,000 square foot gym. We will have a formal entrance to the gym with concessions, as well as a Hall of Fame and that presence of Sachem Pride when you walk in. We envision a weight room and a fitness room and a multi-purpose space. During the day, it could be used for yoga classes, dance classes. It could also be used as an instructional space for other PE or health. We also envision after school in the fall season, it could be a cheerleading room. In the wintertime, a wrestling room. Upgraded locker rooms, athletic offices, trainers' offices, and of course, the ever-needed storage space. Exterior. We envision a multi-purpose field stadium that would allow for football, soccer, field hockey, and lacrosse to be played. We would have a track, baseball fields, softball fields, practice fields, tennis courts, accessibility from the athletic complex to the outside venues, and a true presence of Tribe Nation. Our Futures Program. As Mr. Porter stated earlier about his vision of the program as we move forward, this is really speaking to this as well. One of the things we are hoping for in this new program, in the new Futures Program in structure, is a large open space for collaboration, three small multi-purpose classrooms, one small science lab, which currently they do not have, a reception area, a director office slash conference room, another small collaborative space for small group instruction and other sort of needs for our students, a kitchenette, restrooms, and its own dedicated entrance. We have really worked hard in that program, thanks to Mr. Porter and Mrs. Jamison and the team, to really make sure that that program had its own identity. And the idea is to foster that in a new building. Special education. This is one of the biggest parts of this ed plan because it is one of the most instrumental things you must be able to show to the MSBA. We envision having a special education office, which right now we do not have, truly at the high school. The PPS office that's here at the Nichols would stay here at Nichols. We envision our inclusion program would have small breakout areas throughout the entire building in the Humanities Center as well as STEM. So it would allow for small group instruction to be pulled out of the larger groups, as well as other specialized instruction that's needed. Our language-based program would have its own separate dedicated space because of the nature of the flexible furniture, lighting, and resources that are needed in that space. Our links program would have a dedicated space of our social-emotional program, as well as our AIMS and postgraduate program, or our life skills program. This is something we're really excited about. We envision its own studio apartment that would have technology, the capability to have that same space become a classroom. It would have laundry facilities and a kitchen facility to allow for our students to be able to learn lifelong skills as they move forward in life. The Center for Innovative Studies. This is something that we are most excited about. We envision in our new building that we would have a full fabrication lab at the high school, as well as a maker space. It's important to note, as for this community, that we are not a vocational high school and that the chances of us having true vocational experiences is slim to none. The state just does not allow that experience. However, we have a responsibility to make sure the fact that we can engage vocational experiences in some degree to allow our students to be able to have exploration, taking the current programming that we're doing and the growth of that programming, and to make sure they can bring their things to life. For example, right now our students in CAD, they can only create it on a machine, on the computer. The vision is in a fabrication lab, they can then take that design and actually bring it into the lab and design it. It would have 3D printers. It would have other resources that were in there to allow for all groups in the school or all classes to have some access in some way, shape, or form to that program. And I invite the community as well as the school committee on page 44 and 45 of this document. It does a really nice description of really what the Center for Innovative Studies would be. We envision a joint space of a fabrication lab as well as a maker space. So if you're in English class, to be able to go in and do real collaborative work in a very, very different environment where you're creating, in comparison to maybe a STEM lab that you may be actually using power drills and 3D printers to create a vision of what you're looking to do. Transportation and parking. really just it's imperative that you know as a committee, but also as a community, that it is part of the plan to ensure the fact that there's plenty of parking, and that we have to ensure the fact, working with the architects, that it is speaking to really what our current protocols are. For example, ensuring that we do our best to have two entrances in or exits in and out of that high school property, making sure there's plenty of lighting, making sure there's plenty of handicap parking, and making sure there's multiple exits and entrances to and from campus. The other area that's important towards the end of this document is really what we call key adjacencies, because it really speaks to really how these things would be connected to each other. And in the document, if you would take a peek at it, it's going to show you things like, for example, your administrative suite would be connected to guidance at the health clinic. Performing arts would be its own facility. Athletics, the Learning Commons and Media Center would be the hub in the center of the school. Your special education would be embedded throughout the entire building. Your STEM humanities, your STEM in the Center of Innovative Studies would be housed inside the STEM Center. However, it would have accessibility from the humanities side as well. Our futures program, as well as just all the logistical elements of the school, are embedded in that. Thank you to Mr. Dizel and the DIRT team. There is an extensive plan in this education plan for really what the safety and security of this building would be. And I gave you just the bullet items here of exactly all the different areas that we looked at to ensure the fact that what we envision in a very safe and secure new or renovated high school, from its doors and windows to keys, surveillance cameras, traffic and safety, in-school visibility as you walk into the building, to front office areas as well as to radio communication. And the last two slides, I think, are the most important ones, because I saved these for last. In all of our planning that we did in the month of September, we had to create what was called our guiding principles. And that through all the writing that has happened over the last 3 months, the guiding principles is exactly what you will see in this education plan that we hope, based upon your vote, will move forward to the MSBA. It's rich with 21st century skills. Its learning should be engaged within respective content areas and leading to a robust interdisciplinary approach to teaching and learning. Professional collaboration, flexibility and interchangeable space to provide for a future of a new facility. Complete engagement in college and career readiness for the 21st century learner and citizen. To engage the town of Middleborough as the high school being a community resource. And lastly, to continue to foster the belief that Middleborough High School is home to each and every student. So it is really with an honor to be able to share this with you tonight. And I'd be happy to take any questions that you may have about the document.
Mr. Lambert.
Two quick questions, actually. Why three lunches as opposed to two? I was just curious of that. I know when I worked there, third block was broken up and you had your four lunches in there.
Right.
And I was always concerned with students kind of going to class, leaving class, going to lunch, and then coming back to class. That breakup in learning did always concern me. Is that something that would still occur with the three lunches?
Well, it possibly could. If we were to go to three lunches, it would really change what that middle of the day would look like. Mm-hmm. The recommended has always been the three for us because we were going from four.
Yep.
If it was a two-period lunch, I suppose we could work at that too. I think it just depends upon the size of that space, as well as the ability for us to be able to look at how that day would look. So I think that is really flexible in terms of the numbers of lunches. But I think as we move forward, I think as our schedule evolves as well as we're taking a good look at that as well, it may just possibly be going into a very different looking high school and may come down to being that we can only do two lunches, or we would be able to do lunches, I should say.
Okay. And my second question was, I see a lot of what appears to be new programs. Is this going to require new staff or more staff?
In terms of what, Mr. Lambert?
You have a lot of the centers I'm seeing, you know, looks like, what particular thing pointed out to me?
In an immediate sense, just from the document, there isn't. The only thing that I would maybe say would be a necessity is potentially we would need to be considering the grounds of a high school. But I would also maybe say, too, is that with a fabrication lab and a makerspace, there may need to be a manager of some kind of that. I'm not at a point to say what that would be. Is it a teaching position? Is it more of a manager of a space to make sure that tools and things are provided, supplies and those kinds of things? And that's the research we need to begin. We really felt it was important to have that space in the plan. And then as we move forward to do the research to say, well, how do other schools that have a fabrication lab and a makerspace, how do they manage that? But in an immediate sense, what you see here would require the programming that we're envisioning is taking our current programming and building it.
Good. Thank you. I really enjoyed the thing, the presentation and the write-up. I thought it was very thorough. Thank you.
Thanks.
First of all, thank you, Mr. Brangen. It's a very impressive document. Just two questions for clarifying the, it sounds like the teaching spaces are going to move more to, it's almost like they have each group has like a mini office where they have desks, like a little kitchenette, you know, so it's like a mini office.
Right.
And then the classrooms are going to be, they say they're not going to have their own room. They're going to be assigned rooms, move around. Is that something that's going, is that a common thing that people are heading towards? It feels like more like a college campus.
It is, and I'm glad you asked that question. I should have probably mentioned that when we were chatting when I was presenting a moment ago. In most of your new high school projects, you're going to find that the identity of really this classroom belongs to this teacher all day for the next umpteen million years really is no longer the norm. And really what they look at is how do you take your spaces and constantly keep redesigning the space? So the department offices, what we would envision if as this design process keeps going, what I would hope to see is the fact that you would have history classrooms, you would have math classrooms, because one of the things that I would expect in the building is that when you would walk into our classrooms, they're not barren rooms, like you would see in many colleges. That it would really be, you would see history and you would see math and you would see English. The only difference is that the home base for that teacher would really be in a collaborative space in an office. We as a school had a choice to really say, do we want to do interdisciplinary, meaning it would be an English and a math and a science and a history and so on. And that really wasn't in our plan. It didn't feel comfortable to the staff. They really wanted that identity of a department, but they also wanted to ensure the fact that the building would be designed in a way that you could have a history teacher, then an English classroom next to it, and potentially a foreign language class next to that, to allow some of that collaboration to take place. The potential of a history teacher and an English teacher saying, let's do some joint teaching and make sure those rooms could be next to each other. There were conversations in our training, in our vision planning, that says that many times in schools, the building principal no longer schedules the classrooms. That when you create a section of the building and say to history, you have these five rooms, say, you need to now schedule those rooms. Mm-hmm. So it really does become a very different approach potentially in the future.
Well, it's one of my comments that was about the decorations, because as a middle school teacher, like my room is kind of like mine. I have to decorate it and make sure the posters are up. But if you're doing like this, it seems like there'd be have to be more thought put into how those rooms are, so they're not just blank walls like a. And then my second comment was more of just a compliment. I thought there was a section in your document on the cafeteria space being utilized as a commons. You know, really, I thought that was a great way to utilize that space rather than having the cafeteria sit empty for hours. Right. You know, this way you can really use that space. So congratulations, it's a really nice job.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Other questions?
I would just like to say thank you. It certainly is very comprehensive, and I don't think you left anything out, Mr. Brannigan. Thank you. Makes buying a new car easy, doesn't it?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Having gone through this, having listened to your presentation last evening, read it more than a few times, I keep thinking about how this document, if you read it at face value, it sounds like we're looking for all this new stuff. But after you read it three times, it's not. It's where we're going no matter what. This is where we're headed. Regardless of anything else, but we need to get there. We need the vehicle to get there. So we are going this way. We are going to do this. This is our plan. This is our vision for the future, regardless of the facility, whether we do Plan O, which was one of our options, which is just renovate what we have, or anything else. So I thought that when you keep reading the document, it's not a whole bunch of new stuff. It's where we're headed anyway, which is a key piece. Space utilization, using that space for other things. Throughout the document, we keep talking about how we're going to use it for this and that. It's great. We're not creating a big edifice to somebody that we're going to put a name on and it gets used once every, you know, 10 days. It's going to be used, and that's in this document. One of the other things I noticed is this past Tuesday evening at the one of the choirs, they were singing a song in Spanish. And I always think of the collaboration. I don't know if that was something that was planned, but when I saw that, I said, that's a great use of, you've got a foreign language in music combining and ownership into that foreign language, which was great. They even translated it for the folks before they started. Those are the types of things that we're talking about when we talk about collaboration. It's not nothing new. We can do it, but we want to make it, we're going to foster, we're going to make it better. And this plan shows how that can happen. So I'm, as you can tell, I'm just very excited. I've had a lot of questions. I've asked you to bounce ideas off for the last few days. I've seen you almost every day this week for different events. But I want to thank you and all the people who worked on it, Mr. Porter, everyone who worked on this ED plan, including our design team that worked on it. I know they're getting paid to do it, but you know what? They're still working, and it's great that we're able to have such a great team working on this project.
If I may, Mr. Giovanni, it's important to note that this draft document, it will remain a draft until the MSBA approves it. But one of the things that has been so wonderful about our design team and our project management team is that I would keep sending drafts to them. And within a day and a half, I would have a full edit back that was really about speaking to, from their expertise, you really want to say it this way. I know what you're trying to say, Paul, but you want to make sure you say it in this fashion. So it really became a real collaborative effort of really learning as well of how do you take our current programming and how do you engage it in a way and have language as such that is going to be really an ability for them to then take the vision and actually design it. So it was really quite a fun experience working with them.
Paul, I want to thank you. I do want to make a couple of comments. First, Mr. Rogers and I had a conversation yesterday in our meeting, and so I thanked everybody for the year, and then Mr. Rogers got me thinking, which is, I've been doing this for 2 years now. And this was the piece that we were culminating towards because this would drive everything. I want the community to understand more than anything else that we don't have a 21st century building. In a lot of ways, our kids are shortchanged. Mr. Porter runs a wonderful program, but that's not the way that program should be run. And the reason we can't run it the way it should is the building doesn't allow us to. I remember when I first started on a school committee in the 90s, the Futures program that Mr. Porter had, you know, the best educational plan was to take it outside of the school. It was supposed to be someplace else, so these kids would feel great coming back to the school. That didn't make sense. And the idea to put it in a school made sense. And what happens is it just gets put in space that's available. It doesn't get put in space that's created. And I think you could probably say that, first of all, for every special ed program that we currently have, which is it's put in places that were available over time because we wanted to add those programs so we didn't lose kids outside of district. I had an opportunity when I was first on a school committee to be part of the legislative liaison group for Mass Association of School Committees, and I talked to Brian a lot of times about this particular time. I went to Washington and I met with Senator Kerry, who was senator at the time, and one of the things he implored all of us to remember and recognize was, with the exception of the fire and police department, your schools are the buildings that should be the first opened in the morning and the last closed at night, because they should be where the community goes and the community gets involved in. And it's not just for kids, it's for the community. We don't have that building currently.
we will have that building, whether it be renovated or built new, with this plan. And so I thank you for that, Mr. Brannigan. This is something I greatly look forward to, and I hope that the community will read it and realize what they're getting moving forward, because it's important.
Mr. Chair, if you wouldn't mind, if sure. I could close this segment of the report out. You know, in 50 years or 100 years, somebody may find this document somewhere, and it doesn't have Paul Brannigan's name anywhere on it. It doesn't have it on the underscore. It doesn't have it in the footnotes. It doesn't have it anywhere. But all they'd have to do is check the DNA, and they'd know it came from Paul Brannigan. And I would like to, if you don't mind, indulge me, read Paul's sort of concluding remarks in this 58-page report. And Mr. Brannigan writes, "Today we are a school whose mantra is about being Sachem strong. We believe we are a school of excellence, and this can be demonstrated by walking the halls, visiting classrooms, and experiencing the special place that we call home. Middleborough High School is a special place. The school spirit can be seen in each and every student. We are proud of the school we have become and excited to take our school to the next level. Our vision is that the new Middleborough High School will become a leader in the 21st century teaching and learning. We will be a school that will engage and prepare our students to be college and career ready and to graduate from our high school with a life pathway that is based on excellence. We will be the school that will never settle. We will be the school that will provide an academic program that is second to none. We will be the school that our community will embrace for generations to come and be proud that their children and grandchildren attend the school. The 21st century Middleborough High School will take our students and community to the next level. We have grown within a facility with significant limitations because at Middleborough High School, failure is not an option. Strength leads to excellence, and that is what Sachems do. As we always say, it's a great day to be a Sachem." Paul Brannigan. Thank you, Paul.
Plan is presented this evening.
Do I have a second? Discussion.
Chair?
Yes.
Before I vote, as a member of the school committee for almost 6 years, I have sat here and I have voted some things that I was very excited about, and I had to vote some things that I wasn't. But I want this community to know that I'm about to take a vote on something that I'm very proud of. Mr. Brannigan, thank you very much.
Thanks. Any further discussion? Anyone in the audience have any questions or comments they wish to make? Seeing no one, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Brannigan. And thank you, Mr. Droger. We appreciate your help. Moving on with the superintendent's report.
Perhaps less exciting items. The DEP water testing update. I sent you folks an email late this afternoon. We had an update from Rich Johnson. We do not have any updates beyond what I reported at the last meeting. So we are still waiting to have results. We do have results, like I said, on the Berkeley and MKG at last meeting, and everything was okay in those. I would ask now that if you don't mind me taking out of order, because Mrs. Piattelli has a number of items here. In your packet, and it will be something that we will visit in the future, is the beginning of the strategy for continuous district improvement, which we've been working with as an administrative team over the last two, three-hour sessions that we work at administrative meetings on, coming up with the blueprint for district improvement down the road. Used to be called a strategic plan in this district. We're going to call it the strategy for continuous district improvement, pending your approval. I just wanted to give you an update that this is something that came through the entry plan that I did. It came through the work that I've been doing with the administrators, as I said. Our job is to sort of fill in this plan with how the district will look down the road. Every administrator in terms of the principals and the directors have been involved in this. Our next step is to take this sort of draft document as it is, as it stands, and put it on a rubric and determine whether it has a high impact, a moderate impact, or limited or no impact on students. We have a chart that we work with, which is sort of a a graph with sort of an X and a Y here, but it involves four quadrants. One is what we're about to endeavor to do. Does that have a hard or high impact on the, is it hard to do, and how, does it have a high impact? Is it easy to do, does it have a high impact? Is it hard to do, does it have a low impact? And is it easy to do and have a low impact? So what we're doing now is taking all of our next steps here as administrators before it goes to the school committee, and we are taking each strategic objective and each strategic priority and putting them through this mill, and then the next step is to return to the school committee to vet it through school committee in a more formal way, and then we would come up with the annual action items for improvement priority. So each of the items that you see on the second page, page 2 of 6, are the strategic objectives. Those are the major ones. Strategic priorities are broken down, and then there'll be actions for each of those items. These are based on the hard work and diligence, like I said, of the principals and directors. They've all been involved in this process. They took my entry plan. I reported out my entry plan results. So this is basically a draft document at this point. They've been working on, we'll continue to work on. Just sort of wanted to give you an update that we are in process here. Been working with Jack Ahern with the new superintendent's induction program. This is part of the process that I'm going through in developing this plan, and Jack has worked closely with us on this. And I do thank him, and I thank the administrators for their diligence in working with this strategy for continuous district improvement, which is, like I said, is in draft form now. And I would certainly answer any questions you might have on it this time. If none, there'll be more to follow on this, I assure you. And this will be something that will be vetted through school committee and will need to be approved by school committee. Moving on to a few budget items, and Kathy wants to talk about a few of these. So she's going to talk about a couple of things, and then I'll go back to the records access officer.
Thank you. For the 2018 budget process, we've scheduled two meetings. We had to cancel one because I was ill. I apologize. Monday morning, we're going to meet 9 to 12 with the budget subcommittee for the first part, and then we're going to bring in some of the administrators to present their requests to the committee. And at that time, we'll also schedule out a couple more meetings so we can really kind of have a good idea where we're going by the end of January, so that we'll be really ready for the present to the full committee and then to the selectmen. Electronic pay stubs. Today was our very first day with electronic pay stubs. We had about close to 600 paychecks, and only 62 were in paper because they were live. Everyone else had to log on to the portal to view their pay stubs. So it was good. There were a lot of people who kind of emailed today because they hadn't logged on to get their username and password, so there was a flurry of activity today, but I think it's all going to be really good and save a lot of paper. What's my third thing? Transportation contract. Today we had a mandatory pre-bid meeting. Anyone who wanted to bid on the school bus transportation bid had to show up at this meeting. We had three vendors attend. Mr. Flahigh went through all of the specifications, and they asked questions, and he was able to answer them. We do have to get them some more information. They have to provide any questions they have by next Thursday, and then the bid opening will be January 12th. We had the first student attended, Student Transportation of America, and Lucini Bus. Those were the three.
And you had to attend.
Had to attend, so no one else can apply. So we're looking for that.
Is that common nowadays that you have to attend these things in other school districts, or is it just something Middleborough did on bus contracts?
I think we did it the last time on the bus contract. Because they're so controversial, if, you know, there might be one technical little misprint somewhere and someone gets the wrong information, that by having everyone in the same room and they hear okay. The same questions, and he literally went page for page, and it was like 25 page bid specs.
Okay, thank you.
It's not uncommon, not just in the transportation but other bids as well, that we have these, even for what seems like a small contract of 25 pages. it's a lot of items that go over and everyone gets to see it, which is a key item. One of the comments I was going to make is, in the education plan for the high school, only 14% of our students are utilizing it. That was interesting.
Other transportation.
Only 14% of our students at the high school are utilizing the transportation. Although some may live outside, inside the area where they have to walk, a lot of them that drive it as they get older or have siblings or their parents drop off. But I just thought that was an interesting 14% number.
I didn't know that it was 14% of the high school, the whole population. I mean, our biggest transportation is the elementary.
Right.
Right.
That was just the high school.
Right.
The 14%.
14%
of the population in the high school are using it. I've been told six ride the bus some days with my son, so.
Right. We probably have a lot of juniors and seniors driving, right. So there's not.
That's what they were saying.
Yeah. We might have siblings there driving their freshman, sophomore siblings, too.
But we still need to cover that part of
absolutely.
Town.
Absolutely.
Right.
So. Absolutely.
Yes.
Sorry, were you going to say something, Mr. Lynch?
No.
Any other questions?
Okay. Thank you.
My final item is the item that was added later on in the week, and there's a reason for that. We had a department head meeting on Monday with the Allison Ferreira town clerk, who brought to us the new town process through which Chapter 121 of the Acts of 2016 will be administrated. And she has asked that we have records access officers in each area, hopefully two, just in case somebody else is ill. But there are new public records laws that are much more transparent and expedite the process, make it less expensive for folks, and so that folks can have more access. This was voted on June 3rd, I think, 2016, the Acts of 2016. And we, basically at our school system, have decided that we have a couple people in the central office, one being Ann Gagnon and one being Jessica Priestley, who will be those records access officers who these emails will go to. It'll be on the website if anyone's looking for access. They would go to their email addresses, send an email to them, and then we would have to turn it around in accordance with the law. There are also some other items that this town has put in place. The town is going to have a tracking system, a computerized tracking system that is not in place yet, but it will be. Right now, we will not have access to that. It's a public records management application. They're trying to expand sort of the memory of this program, the capability of this program to include the school system, but at this point, it does not have the capabilities. We're hopefully maybe looking at a system of our own if we can through Ms. Driscoll and the technology office. But at this point, we will keep our own records. We have occasionally have requests for school records, and we would, in a lot of cases, if it's something that came from let's say a college in California looking to a study and comparative study in Massachusetts schools versus Michigan versus California, they send out a bulk request for records. We would have time to respond to them and indicate to them what it would cost us to do that, the man hours, the female woman hours, what it would cost, and there are limitations now on how much we can charge for that. But we would let them know that that would give us a little more time to prepare that. If they're asking for one document, obviously we can turn that around in an awful hurry. We had a request from a school system, from a law office representing a school system, looking for the number of special ed teacher postings we'd had in the last 3 years, which we were able to turn around pretty quickly for them. And it didn't cost a lot of money. It didn't take a lot of time. So that being said, there are easy records requests and they're more difficult. The more difficult ones will go through a process now, but they'll be sort of time dated, time stamped, and minimized. We just can't say sort of a willy-nilly amount. There are certain amounts assigned to each page that we have to reprint, and the hours that we can, the money we can charge, maximum of $25 per hour to do all the work, the secretarial work required. So it's a new law. It requires us to have RAOs, a new term, and they're records access officers, and we need to have a couple of them in the school system as I see it, and that's a little bit of an item later.
Am I correct in saying, Mr. Lynch, that this needs to be done for January 1st?
Yes. Correct. The new law goes into place January 1st. That's correct.
And these names will be placed on our website, And my question would be, would it be a single email? Would it be like rao@middleborough.k12? And that way there, both of these people get the email if one's absent or not. I don't know how that would work.
I'm guessing that's probably would be a good way to do it.
We want to make sure. If,
that's a wonderful suggestion. That's just, not something we had on the record, but that is rao@middleborough.
That way there, it's easy and people can remember it, and the state might even be happy with it, because the state's really wanting that name or that access name on that website, almost like that. So
good suggestion.
Thank you. And what I'd like to do is, I'd like to take this appointment action item, because we have to do it. I'd move that we appoint Ann Gagnon and Jessica Priestley as records access officers for the Middleborough Public Schools.
Do I second? Discussion. Question. Mr. Lambert.
With that, being given this additional title, does this cause more pay?
There's no additional stipend, Mr. Lambert, no. Okay. This would be part of their duties and responsibilities as office personnel in the superintendent's office.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Just so everyone knows, a couple of things. One is both Ann and Jessica have attended at MASC, runs the Administrative Professionals Day on the Friday. They both attended the workshop on the RAOs as part of that. So they did attend a course, if you will, and are versed in what they have to do. I would also tell the community that in order to get a records request now, it is imperative that you email the officer that you're supposed to email. So for example, an email to the superintendent of schools, which I'm certain the superintendent will handle, does not necessarily meet the requirement under the law. You have to send the note to the RAO. That's the requirement. And so the other thing that I'd say, internally amongst the school committee, if you get somebody who asks you for a records request, I would ask that you forward that email to Ann or Jessica so that they can process that for people. We all know that at times people will ask us for certain things, and we want to make sure it follows through.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I'd step back and I would suggest that they email the RAO, because if they think that they sent us one and we have that 10-day window thing, we're not the RAO, or if we do it, we want to make sure that other person, that, because God forbid someone's out for a couple of days and not looking at their email, and you're 7 days now versus 10. I don't want anyone to say we weren't transparent and expediting things. We try.
Any further comments or questions? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Includes the superintendent's report for this evening.
We had a discussion on MSBA. We talked about yesterday's meeting. We'll continue. The submissions will happen next Friday. And so it's a pretty thick book that gets sent to MSBA. And so that will be sent out. Myself, the chairman of the selectmen, and Mr. Lynch have documents that we have to sign on next Wednesday to meet those requirements, and so the three of us all know about it and are going to participate in that and make sure we sign them. Did you want to talk a little about the early ed?
I will. The latest update on the MEC is that we now have a punch list that's only three items deep or long, and there's a couple of very quick things that the engineering company, MDM Engineering, has to get up on top of that roof to complete, and at that point the final requisition will be signed and the project will be closed out, and then we'll have final reports for you. The last piece was that infrared examination, which was done, which was completed. Russo Barr is a company that came in as what's called the commissioning, or the CX, the commissioning agent. They come in and they looked at it, and they determined that there was a couple of things. One would be a sort of a landing pad when somebody climbs up the ladder and gets off and lands on the roof, a place where they could land and walk to that next hard place. That wasn't there. So there are a few things that they have suggested that need to get done for the project to be deemed complete, and we're very close. We're that much closer, and hopefully this will be off the agenda item at some point in the very near future.
But it should be noted that we are still under budget.
$250,000 plus under budget, yes.
Any other questions about the MEC or MSBA? Hearing none, I'm just going to go to, yes, sir. Sorry, I saw you, please.
Where are those options on the website? These are the five options that are narrowed down.
The five options piece has not been put on there. It'll be put on there. I know our OPM, our owner's project manager, Christy, is working on that. I was sitting next to her last night, and she said she was going to get that in the next day or so.
All right.
She had a couple other things I know she was trying to get done for the big submittal, so I didn't want to press her on it.
I thought you said they were on the website.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. They're going to be placed. The original all options are on there.
Right.
But it was pared down to five.
All right.
So that will be put on as just individual slides, and I'm hoping that it'll be done so that the selectmen can mention it their next meeting as well.
All right. Thank you.
For our policy subcommittee, Mr. Stevens, do you want to talk about the substance abuse prevention and education policy that we met on?
I didn't see it in our packet, but.
No, it was on before.
Oh, okay.
So this would be about the second meeting, one more meeting to pass it.
Okay.
But we did meet.
We did meet the subcommittee with Mr. Lynch, and we reviewed it, and I mean, everything looked appropriate. He used a standard template from the
MAS.
Yeah, so it was a standard template. We didn't change anything. So, yeah, not much else to report on that.
And we'll, I'll make sure it's dropped back in your boxes for next meeting. That'll be our third reading, and we can vote on it. This is a requirement of the new substance abuse law in Massachusetts. We are supposed to have put it on our website, which we have in draft form. We believe we meet the requirements of the state at this time. And so and to be honest with you, from what we've heard, is everybody has it on their website in draft form currently because they're filling it out. And so we can finish this up at next meeting.
So at that point, right?
Yeah. Action items?
Oh, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Before we leave policy subcommittee, just an update on negotiations.
Oh, sure.
Next week, we will be meeting with the minibus drivers to begin negotiating of that contract. So I just want to make mention that to the folks sitting here and the folks at home, if you're interested.
Thank you. Action items, we handled the appointment of the RAO, we handled the education plan, we just have a school committee meeting minutes.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I move that we approve the regular session meeting minutes of October 6, 2016.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Mr. Chair, I move that we approve the regular session meeting minutes of October 20th, 2016.
Do I hear a second? Discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Of course, I have no other action items.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
If we could look at regular session, I'm sorry, executive session minutes, if anyone has any disapproval of or want to discuss them tonight outside of this, can I approve them now?
We've done that in the past.
Yep. Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I would move that we approve the executive session meeting minutes of July 21st, 2016, Part A and Part B. It's all one big thing.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I move that we keep executive session meeting minutes July 21st, 2016's Part A and Part B, Part 1, Part 2, executive session at this time.
Do I hear a second? Discussion.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I actually did review these thoroughly, and I thought we might be able to open up one of them, but there is some discussion that is kind of strategy based on some of the union contracts that we have been approving, or else I would have said, let's open them. So that's the reason why I want to keep them closed.
Absolutely. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Any further action items that anyone has? Hearing none. Correspondence? I don't believe we have any tonight, other than we did get from the committee a nice card from the police department. So I wishing us a happy holiday, so I wish to thank them.
We do have on the session, executive session for procedure 3 to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation if an open meeting may be detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigation position of the public body, and the chair so declares, and I do declare.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I move that we enter that executive session for that reason, with the purposes of coming out for the sole purposes of adjournment.
Do I hear a second? Discussion. Hearing none, this requires a roll call vote. Mr. Stevens?
Aye.
Mr. Gillis?
Aye.
Mr. Lambert?
Aye.
Mr. Giovannone?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. And we will only reconvene to adjourn. So thank you very much, everybody, and happy holidays, and we appreciate all the help we had tonight. Thank you.